Is this Friday? Well, mine next Wednesday.
How about this class or different class? How about this class or different class?
It's speaking.
Tell me, you ready
to go? Yep, I got three. Yeah. Yep. Okay. Thank you. Professor King.
Mine do this. Hey, mine do the day before the last day. Yeah, next Wednesday.
You don't have a name, but I need you to make a homemade one today. But what? Put something up in front of you, please. Bring it. So it's my distinct honor and pleasure first to be with you here on a Monday.
Hey.
How cool is that? Because I only get to see you on Friday. So it's cool to be here hanging out with you. We have guests in our leadership class this morning. And I've got the privilege to bring and share him with this class. Dr. Tim Moore coming to us from pretty exciting career journey. And one of the things that's been pretty important to me as it relates to your educational experience and preparing your travels as you're embarking upon what you're going to do in your career, you might have an end goal. You know, I've heard I want to be, you know, a broadcast announcer, or maybe I want to be an athletic director, I want to go play professionally, whatever it is, you may have that end goal, but sometimes seeing what those pieces look like on the way to where you're going, that may look a little bit different for everybody. So what you have in the room this morning, you've got three of the most powerful athletic directors, former athletic directors on the continent in this room, and, at least two. So I get to be in really good company because being a part of athletics in some aspects is really a privilege for us working with young people, but we bring somebody else today who has done all of the above, and you get a chance to kind of see through their lens of what their journey has been. I've also shared the questions that we put together on Friday with them. So if you would give your, and I've also put up here so you can see, this is not all of what Dr. Orr has done, it's just a little bit
awesome
of what his journey has been, so you can see that as well, not very much to you. So without further ado, here's my distinct honor to present you, Dr. Orr.
How would you define success? Go ahead, Austin. You got that looking at And how you see yourself, it's like, okay, anybody else? How about you? And great answers from everybody. Great answers. And do you know about 95% of people in the world will say something similar to what y'all say? 95%. But let me share with you what I've learned from my trials. How would I define success? Success is giving everything you got in order for someone else to be successful. How many of y'all are members of a team? How many of y'all? One thing you got to realize, how would you define success? Success is, I'm an old offensive lineman. Y'all probably can tell by my belly and all that. I'm an old offensive lineman. And East Carolina. And what success was, what we was taught is that success is giving everything I got so my teammate can be successful. Once you realize that your value and success is not based on you, but how you impact others, that's when you got it. But it takes a lot to get to that point. It takes a lot. A lot of times, everybody, like I said, 95% success is all about me. But one thing, if you don't hear nothing else from this old man, you don't hear nothing else today, what I want you to understand is that success is how much you, when you give everything you got for someone else to be successful. As a coach, it was like, it gave everything I got for my players to be successful. As an administrator, I gave everything I got for my coaches to be successful. As an educator, I gave everything I got for my students to be successful. That's what success is. And then, when they go down the road, I see them doing wonderful things, being great people, then I say, okay, I did a good job. Because once you realize in this world, it's not about you. Anytime you evolve in athletics, anytime you involve any type of organization, the whole is greater than the part, individual part. It's not about you, it's about the whole overall organization or team. So hopefully you got that something there. It's something different, okay? Okay. Now, what we're going to talk about today is, as I mentioned to you, I teach an organizational leadership graduate course. And we're studying a book from John Carr, The 8 Steps to Acceleration of Change. And I understand some people, you know, probably familiar with old Stephen Covey's book, Seven Habits of Effective Leadership. So, well, I'm just going to kind of compare those two today, talk, highlight a couple of their principles, and kind of talk about how that applied to my journey in the athletics and sports industry. Now, what do I know about leadership? So I do this because I just want to break down, tell you a little bit about myself. Again, former Division I student athlete, East Carolina, former athletic director at Livingstone right down the road. I've been an athletic administrator at multiple different institutions. I also served as director of marketing and public relations for the Southern Intercollegiate Athletic Conference. I served as, I'm right now currently, I am the coordinator of the Sports Administration Graduate Program at Hampton University. I also chaired the Committee on Athletics. I published several articles and on the sports industry. Actually, recent one, Division II faculty's perception of athletic reform. And also, again, father of two, got 19-year-old twins, freshmen in college, so you know I'm broke. So, and I served on the Deacon Board and got my home church. And also the Living Greatest Fraternity, Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated. But I had that in some of y'all kind of lost. That's not good at y'all looking lost. But anyway, but no, but seriously, I also want to share, you know, the journey to where I am. Some people always see the results. Oh, I want to be like that person. I want to be like, they don't see the grind that you went through to get there. You know, there was a saying, and I always use this for my players, I always say, I say, you know, everybody wants to be a beast until it's time to do what beasts do. Everybody wants to be something until they realize it's time to put that work in. Mm-hmm. Then all of a sudden, they got excuses why they don't want to do it. And, you know, on my wall, I got a saying, don't confuse activities with accomplishments. Results are what count. So what does that mean? Just don't go through the motion to say you're doing something. Have a purpose of what you're doing. Have some direction in what you're doing in order to reach a goal. Because the bottom line is people care less what you're doing. They just want to see the result. They just want to see the end result. Don't confuse activities with accomplishments. So if you're just going through the motion and not accomplishing nothing, you're really wasting your time. You want to look, accomplish something, have a sense of purpose, a sense of urgency, moving forward. Okay? All right. Now, let's talk a little bit about these two. And they got some similarities and all, and I just want to highlight a few. I'm not going to spend as much time on it with this class, but just a couple of things. Step one, in Carter's book, he talks about the sense of urgency. It's important. But now, you got to have a sense of urgency in your time. So anytime you have a task or a project that you want, you got to have a sense of urgency. You know, the one thing I hop on my 19-year-old son, you got to have a sense of urgency. You can't sit around dragging and doing it on your own time because you won't get further. Sooner or later, somebody's just going to say, well, yeah, if it's not important to you, I'm going to move on. So whatever you do as a leader, have a sense of urgency. Have a sense of urgency. And then in Kobe, he talks about being proactive. And one thing is, learn the ability to examine our own character. It's like, we as humans have the unique opportunity to examine ourselves and see, you know, where can I improve? What can I do to get better? Be proactive. You don't have to sit around and wait. You can actually examine your past and make a change. So take advantage of that. Okay. Yeah. Building a guiding coalition. Basically, what Carter talks about in acceleration of change is that the importance of relationship. One thing, and then with this class, how many of y'all are interested in trying to pursue a career in the sports industry or intercollegiate athletics? Do we got many? A few? Okay. Biggest thing I'm gonna tell you, one of the biggest factors in the sports industry, relationship. That's what it's based on. Relationship. Now, when I first out of college, now, did I know I was gonna be an athletic director or be a football coach or be a professor? Didn't have a clue. Not even close. Y'all wanna know what my undergrad degree was in? Industrial technology, technical sales and service. Mm-hmm. You wanna tell you how many days I worked in that industry? Zero. So now, let me tell y'all this, and I'm just gonna throw this in there. So if you look at the statistics and talking about how effective were your programs, your undergraduate programs, and they looked at my situation, East Carolina would have got a zero. They would be a failure if they looked at me. But I never worked a day in my undergraduate career. But am I successful? Yes. So it's amazing. When you talk about intercollegiate, you know they do those polls and statistics determining the effectiveness of a program. So I say that to say, your map is not going to always be straight and narrow. You're going to get sidetracked all the time. So how did my journey start? I came out of college looking for a manufacturing management job, no luck. Had to find something, had to pay bills. First job I got out of college was selling cars. Can you believe that? selling cars. But as I look back on my journey, the thing that I realized, what I got from this, from selling cars, is that it helped me with communication, helped me build, with building relationships, getting out and talking to people. So I can appreciate my journey going through selling cars. But I was working selling cars one day. I read this article in Sports Illustrated. It was the general manager from the Charlotte Hornets. And this was back, had to be back in the late 80s. Anyway, what he talked about was a sports management degree. And I'm like, we didn't have nothing like that in East Carolina. He talked about what he does. I said, well, you know, I like sports and I like business, you know. Maybe I can combine the two. So I did something I never thought I'd ever do. I wrote, you know, y'all might don't know this today. We didn't have email. I had to write him a letter. I actually wrote a pen, write a letter. I know y'all don't know that. Anyway, but seriously, I wrote him a letter, and lo and behold, he responded and called me, and we talked, and I'm like, wow, that blew me away. I was on the phone with the general manager for the Charlotte Hornets. And we talked, and he shared with me some ideas to it. You know, the main thing, you probably have to go get your degree, get some experience, get some knowledge, get some technical background. So I ended up going and getting my master's. And when I was there, so at the time I was working, I got my master's, I was working as director of marketing public relations for the conference. And I was invited to a basketball tournament. And in the basketball tournament, Rick Pitino, everybody knows who Rick Pitino is, right? Former UK coach and all that. He was, at the time, I liked that UK at that time. But coach, I'm telling you, it was a two-day tournament in Atlanta, Georgia. And I was just amazed. I literally just followed him everywhere he went. And I'm like, wow. Is that what it's like to be a college coach? I just did what I was told y'all about. I saw the result. I didn't see the grind. That's what I want to do. If I can have that kind of impact, that's what I'm doing. I want to be a coach. So I ended up going and getting they call it restricted earnings. Y'all might not be familiar. It's the GA because they had GA, but restricted earnings is that sort of a GA position, but you don't go to school, you actually get paid. You don't get paid much, but you get paid. So that was how I got started in the coach out in Idaho State. And so it was just a great opportunity. But just like I said, the journey, then I went from coaching, and I was 20 years, Division I, Division II coaching. And I thought, well, you know, that's what I'm going to do the rest of my life. Just coach, coach, and coach. But you know what happens? You get older. You get family. Mm-hmm. And your priorities change. Mm-hmm. Your priorities change. And what happened to me was I ended up I was coaching. Matter of fact, I came out as assistant head coach and defensive coordinator here at Livingston. And what happened was NCAA compliance position came open. The assistant athletic director for compliance position came open. And they knew I had experience working with compliance at some other institution. They said, well, Tim, why don't you, I'm going to go ahead and work with you. Why don't you do it? You got the experience. I mean, you've done it before. I mean, I know you've never done it full time, but you've done it before. And it'd be a more smoother transition than someone else. So, give it a shot. I never know. Go for it. So, and I did. And then one thing led to another. I went from compliance officer then to become an athletic director. And what does that mean? What I'm trying to share with y'all is be willing to volunteer. Be willing to take a chance. Don't expect to go the one, you know, like this is the way I got to do cookie cutter and this is the way it's going to be. Take a chance. You never know. Don't be afraid to step out of your comfort zone. That's one thing as people we always do. We stay in our comfort zone, and then we just kind of blah, 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 and go through life. You got to be willing to take a chance. Step out of your comfort zone. Volunteer. I volunteered when I told you about going to, after I talked to the guy at the with the Charlotte Hornets, I went and volunteered at the local college I was at. I didn't have a clue. I just was trying to get some experience. And I went and volunteered and I helped put me in with the sports information director. And we ended up getting the national award for the football media guys that I did. So I'm like, okay, you know, start off pretty good. But it was, that's the thing, be willing to volunteer, be willing to get out your comfort zone, don't think you know all the answers, and just take a chance. You never know where it's gonna lead you. So do that, I recommend every, if you get an opportunity, go for it. You know, a lot of people, you know, don't wanna leave and go this far, and don't wanna do this, don't wanna do that, please. You never know, you can always come back home. But you know, the one thing I say, you don't want to be that old man in the rocking chair when you're old and gray, I'm getting close. You don't want to be that man sitting on the rocking chair saying, you know, what if I would have did that? What would my life be like? I think that's the worst regret you can ever have. What if I didn't take that chance? I didn't just get out of my comfort zone. What happened if I would have took that job? You never know. Okay. But let's go to this. We talk about go to strategic vision. As a leader, as a head coach, as an administrator, you gotta get buy-in. You gotta have a vision. That's your role as a top-level manager. You gotta be the visionary. You gotta deliver the purpose. Why are you here? Why are people in this organization? What is your vision? What is your purpose? You're the one that has to direct that. If you can do that, you can be successful. Putting first things first, prioritize. You know, they talked about beginning with end in mind, then they say put first things first. You always tell the guy to get kind of work, you know, have purpose in what you do. Have purpose in what you do. Because you want to be the best that you can be in that particular situation. So work hard at it. And continue to prioritize, and you'll be successful. Enlist the volunteer army. Why do you think it's important? If you was AD, and y'all are planning to put on a basketball tournament, why would you think it'd be important to have a volunteer army? Why do you think it's important to get a group of volunteers to help? Why? Any idea? Let me see who we got. Mont, what you think? What's the benefit of having volunteers? Okay. All right, let me put you on the spot. Let me put you on the spot. Madison, what you think?
Most of the time, it's easier for a group of people to do jobs than just one person.
Okay. Ashley, what you think?
That's what I was going to say. It's easy to work as a unit if there are multiple parts that have to get done.
Okay. Let me add to it. Great answer. Let me add to it. If somebody volunteers for something, what's the first thing? What does that mean? What's the first thing they mean? That means? And that, okay, that's true. They're interested. They're bought in. Yep. As a leader, you got to get buy-in. That's what it means by that volunteer army. Get people that want to be a part of it. You're not forcing them. You're not mandating that they do it. You ask for volunteers. So that means, first of all, they want to do it. Okay? That's half the battle. They want to be a part of something. Then by doing that, then what does the army do? What do they do? It gives you different perspectives. As leaders, as administrators, as coaches, whatever it might be, as a leader, more perspective that you get, the better decisions you can make. You get a variety of opinions, people from diverse backgrounds, people from different opinions. They can bring a different perspective, and y'all learn to work together, you can make a better product. Mm-hmm. That's why it's so important to get about it, get older generation, younger generation, you know, socioeconomic interest, you know, the wealthy, middle class, whatever it might be, you know, ethnicity, whatever it might be. But the thing is, diversity brings a better solution together. And that's what you need. A diversified group that can come together with a broader perspective will provide a better product. Okay? Enabling action by removing as OAD now, and I'm trying to tell you, majority of my life, I worked at HBCU. And the one thing that I have to overcome in any role I've been in, as a leadership role I've been in, the first thing I always had to overcome, well, we've been doing it this way all the time. Well, it used to work this way in the past. Why change it? Why are we going to change it? This is all we know. You got to get rid of that. Because you're never going to evolve. Okay? You got to find a way to evolve your organization. Because if everything was fine, they wouldn't need a new leader. So obviously, some type of change has to make. As y'all progress and y'all move forward, that is one of the sure signs. When you start getting that, because it can come in any typical ways. Like I said, it's just not done that way. We tried, but it didn't work before. And I'm sure complacency, silos, that's the worst thing you can do. People working in their own silo. Left-handed don't know what the right hand is doing. In the situation, I share with you, let's give you an example. You have an athletic department and a business department. And you know, this is just going to take care of the business. Athletics just going to take care of athletics. So they don't know what they're doing, they don't know what they're doing. But can you imagine? What if they just work together? You can get some of these business students to do a marketing campaign or social media public relations for an event. Kind of give a new perspective on things to try to make the event better. Again, not only does the athletic department improve, can it get more awareness of their event, hopefully get more attendance, more revenue, and then what you do for the students, you give them hands-on experience. So when they go out in the real world and they say, well, have you ever done it? Oh, yeah, I've done this. I've worked with the athletic department. We put this program on. That's when getting out of your silos and working together. And that's what's neat, okay? All right. Seek, first understand and then to be understood. As I talked about relationships, and in another class, it talked about qualities of a leader. You got to be passionate. You have to be passionate about what you do. Okay? You got to care. It got to mean something to you. If it means something to you, that means you can seek to understand. You can understand. You want to make sure everybody's successful. You kind of get an understanding of where other people's perspectives are. Because everybody's not going to agree with you. Okay? Because I trust it. If you're in the room and everybody thinks the way you think, you're in the wrong room. And I always joke with people, I say, if you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room. You need to get out that room real quick. You never want to be the smartest person in the room. Because you're never going to grow. You should always be looking to learn. All right? So, but getting back. It talks about different perspectives, being understood, caring. You know, you're talking about caring. You have to be passionate and caring. You know, leaders have to be critical thinkers. They have to be able to bounce back after adversity. Those qualities. But the main thing is being passionate and caring. And that's understanding other people, building those relationships, okay? Create short-term win. Why is it important to have a short-term win? Why is it important? Was that Talik? Why is short-term wins important? What you think?
What do you mean by like short-term wins?
You tell me, what do you think when you hear that? What you think? Talking about short-term wins. You're a leader of an organization.
Well, it's probably like, you know, like how you have long-term goals and like short-term goals. So it's like not as big as your long-term goals, but like little things that you can just like accomplish on the way to your long term goal.
Okay. Then why is that?
Because it's not gonna just like get to the top. It takes steps to get there. So like it's probably part of the steps to get to whatever you're trying to get to.
Okay. You searching, but you're getting there. Yeah. You searching, but you're getting there. Okay. One of the things why short term win is so important is because when you are involved in a process, people are, they're human. Human nature kicks in. A lot of people not going to grind for you if you're not, if they still don't see any progress. They don't see that you've been successful. What a short-term win does is see some big, they get some recognition. They feel good about what they're doing. That gets more buy-in. Because remember I talked about before, the key is the leader to make sure you get people to buy in. They got to see these victories. And the victories take forever. And if you're working on projects, it's going to take 5 to 6 years. People not going to grind like they've been grinding, and they don't see no victories in the first 6 months or a year. Usually short terms, we talk anywhere from 6 months to 12 months, 18 months, whatever it might be. But you, short term, you got to have some recognition, some type of accomplishment, sense of accomplishment. Because when you win, it makes you feel good, right? Anybody get upset when they win? You feel like, okay, everything is working well. We can get better. We can keep moving. It motivates you, right? That's what it's all about. That's in life. Create short-term wins. When you have people working for you, just don't keep them grinding and keep them grinding. Yeah. Recognize the small victory. And that's what they're going to need to motivate them to keep going when doing those tough days, the long days. Okay? Keep that in mind. Synchronize, basically, working together, coming together as a unit. It's more important. Your vision, my vision, let's come together, synchronize, and make sure we develop the best product. And we kind of talked about that constantly. Okay? Again, you don't want to lose sight when we talk about you start plateauing out. How many of y'all work out? Okay, good. That's what I'm talking about. That he's getting his workout in. You're working out. You ever got to the point where you work out so much and all of a sudden you just plateau out and you just say, oh man, no matter what I do, I just can't get anymore. I just can't keep going no more. See, like I'm not improving anymore. But see, the thing is, you got to find ways to accelerate and maintain. So that means that if you plateau, find a different way, but continue to work to get better. As a leader, you have to do that same thing. You have to continue to find a way to get better. You got to be creative. You got to be inventive and try to help change to make things better. But continue to work it. Just don't keep doing it the same way over and over. Because you get stuck in that what? Well, we done done it this way the whole time. That's all we know. Be prepared to change. Work to change. Okay? And then the last one, it just talks about institute change. Just kind of work towards making sure that you change. Making sure that you work hard in order to achieve your goals. And again, as a leader, one of the things you always want to have to do is have to institute change. Because if they didn't need change, they wouldn't have hired you. So you're there for a reason. You just got to know how to do it. Okay? Now, are there any questions before I move on? Are there any questions? Hopefully, something was said that kind of gives you some couple of nuggets. Was there anything, any questions? Okay. Mm-hmm. Good on. Okay. How many of y'all still awake? Okay. I'm a question mark. You all right?
I'm good, sir.
Okay, good. We got a couple still awake. Come to it. Okay, I got some of the questions, y'all, so I'm going to go ahead and address these. Just like I said, maybe it might spark some other questions. We can keep the dialogue going. Talk about, as a football coach, how did you manage such a large number of players on the team? Okay. One thing, as a coach, one thing I learned is that treat everybody fairly, you don't treat everybody equal. Treat everybody fairly, you don't treat everybody equal. There's a difference. Okay? Now, one of the things I used to do, because certain people have certain roles. You understand the inner dynamics of your organization, of your group. And what I always did was I created what I call a core group of leaders. You didn't have to be a starter. You didn't have to be a senior. You had to be a leader, people that on that group would listen to and respect. Once you identify those people, you get about 3 or 4 people that could then, I will meet with them. You don't necessarily have to you got to get some kind of help. You don't necessarily have to continue to talk to the whole group, because as a coach, man, how many student athletes I got here? Okay, all right. So with and your coach keep talking all the time, they start nagging, right? And get on your last nerve and you tune them out.
Yeah.
It happens, right? As you're a student athlete, does that happen? Don't that coach keep talking after a while? My last nerve, right? Right? Okay, everybody agree. So we recognize that. So one thing that I did was I created a core group. What this core group does is that they speak for you. You got to get buy-in from them. If they can get buy-in from them, they can spread it to the rest of the team. And what happened was that, you know, you get them going, and then like I said, Whitney Brown would be a whole lot more receptive to her teammate talking to her and trying to get her together than she would a coach keep nagging. So because they in the grind together. They in the blood, sweat, and they in the trenches together. So you kind of respect them a little bit more. So that's one way, that's one of the ways I handle it. What led you to be a coach? All right. Like I told you before, coming out of college, I didn't have a clue. Well, I didn't even thought about being a coach. But what happened? Rick Pitino, I shared your story about my Rick Pitino story. How do you keep players motivated? And I'm telling you, it was tough. When I was DC at Livingstone, our offense was, and I'm not joking, statistically ranked last in the country. So you know times were bad. They were ranked last in the country. It got to a point in some games, the offense gave up more points than the defense. So you're trying to say, how do you motivate your defense? Because we were ranked pretty good defensively that year. We were nationally ranked defensively. And it's like, how in the world did you motivate them in this situation? When I realized players are human nature. They're people. Recognition. So what I used to do is I used to have player of the week, big hit of the week, big time, whatever it might be, you know. Sometimes then they got a certificate. And you know, after a while, and then I used to have their charts on the wall with points system got the highest grade. And you know, after a while, you know, you notice it works when on Monday when they come to the locker room, first thing they do is they go to that board and see who's and then, well, cool, you missed my tackle. I did this, I did that. That's when you know you got it. Okay. So human nature, working with people. Let them recognize that you appreciate what they've done. That will keep them motivated even in a difficult situation. How do you deal with coaches that were difficult to work with? Okay. First thing is my prime example right here. The one thing I always get in a difficult situation, I always reach out to my mentor. Always. You've been in a situation before you have. You get a different perspective. They might have thought of some things that you haven't thought of. I always seek counsel from women. I always told them, if you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room, I always go to the other room. Make sure I'm in the right room. So you seek counsel, get some ideas and suggestions. And then you meet with that coach. One thing I always do, I don't just cut ties right off the bat. I try to figure out what's going on, try to talk about it, about what I perceive is going on and what is the expectation. Once they understand that, then try to come up with a plan to help improve, to help you get there. Because what did I tell you before? Because in order for you to be successful, my definition of success is what? Helping everybody else be successful. So I got to ask myself, did I do everything I can to help this coach be successful? And if I say no, if I can't say yes, I got to check myself. What I need to do. But if I can say yes, then I know I can move forward. Okay. What's the hardest thing about a budget for the AD? To me, one of the most difficult, challenging things were, first of all, at a low resource institution, it's the funding aspect of if you have to make a decision whether or not to cut or eliminate a team. That is the worst thing you ever do. You got to fight because I've always took the approach, and I was different. You know, some ADs, well, we can cut here, we can cut there. You know, when you get them higher levels, Well, just cut this. Just cut. We'll cut 20% off this. Cut. And I'm saying, okay. I always look at the approach. How can I increase it? What can I do to make things better before I have to cut it? How can we improve the revenue? How can we get more resources? And that's the one thing I try to do, you know. But then, because, you know, you can't always depend. You start depending on subsidies to try to support your programs, and it can become difficult, especially state-funded institutions as well. So it can be a challenge.
Dr. Orr, can I ask a question? Kind of back to your PowerPoint presentation where you talked about seek first to understand, then to be understood. What if you could talk about earning the right to be heard in a room? I think sometimes as young leaders, I think you have two different types of people. Those who come into the room and talk too much, and then those who don't talk enough. You know, how, like, if they're interning, let's say they're with the Hornets or with an organization, you know, how do you want those new leaders to come in? Because you've brought them into your team, but at the same time, sometimes it's okay to be an observing person before you add to the dialogue.
And that's a great question. And the one thing you have to understand is that you have to create a culture of your organization. What is the culture? When you set the dynamic, is it a culture where everybody understands the chain of command? Is it a culture where you feel that you can just come up there and say anything? And that has to be established from the beginning as you develop. What is the culture in which we're going to have this organization? Because, and then the unwritten, you know, they talk about the unwritten rules, the unwritten laws of your organization. How do people understand what is not said, what is observed? Mm-hmm. And that could be a situation where they should understand that at this point, don't necessarily need to speak out. You understand the procedure, who you need to talk to in order to get your opinion heard. But it all comes from establishing the culture of the organization. And I think it's important, as you go in as an intern, and you understand, the first thing you got to do is observe the culture. You got to observe what's going on. And once you do that, I think that will benefit you. Hopefully that helps.
Thank you.
Any scandals? Of course, you know, you dealt with scandals. I think probably the worst scandal I dealt with was just the allegation of sexual assault from student athletes with students. But it was difficult to get everything involved and interviewing people and talking to people, but we got it settled. So that was the main thing. That's about the easiest sport to manage as AD. We all know the easy sport. But what helps is that you're in a situation where you might have, it's always challenging. It's always something unexpected comes up. But it always helps if you got people that's qualified, that has a compliance, understanding of seriousness, nature of compliance, understand budgetary needs and resource allocation. So if you have coaches that are understanding that, that kind of helps ease the management of any type of team. But like I said, there is no easy thing. What made you choose what you're doing there in your career? I guess, again, your journey can throw you from different terms. And you're not necessarily, you have an idea, but that necessarily means that's the way it's going to go. You have to be flexible and adjust. That's one thing I can share with you about life. You got to be flexible and adjust. Because you never know. You might not see yourself doing this. Because I'm telling you, right now, I'm in my 13th year in higher education and teaching. And if you would have asked me 20 or 30 years ago, you're going to teach? Why don't you teach? You know, you got a knack for it. I said, man, please, I'll never teach a day in my life. Never in my life would I teach. And look at me now. Never say no. Because you never know. I'm telling you. I'll never forget. And I'm joking. I'm going to close it over there. When I was an assistant football coach at a high school. And part of the job was in order to teach, you had to teach classes. and they didn't have any teaching opportunities at the high school. I had to teach at the middle school. And anybody know any middle school teachers? Any of y'all don't know them? Anyway, they need to get all the credit in the world. They need any type of raise they want, yes. They are heroes. Because in middle school, them little bad A kids, they're at the age where they know they're too small and you can't do nothing to them, but they're older and they're going to try to push the envelope as far as they can. Huh? Praise those middle school teachers. That was my worst experience ever. I did a semester. After a semester in that classroom with those middle school kids, I said, Lord, let me get back to college football. Find a way to get me back to college football. I said, Lord, you can help me with this. You never have to worry about me anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, but like I said, just joking time, but just realize that life is going to give you different opportunities. And as I shared with you before, take chances. Get out your comfort zone. You know, be willing to take a chance. Because you never know where that door is going. I mean, I was a young man in Atlanta, Georgia, doing well, and I took a restricted earnings coaching job in Pocatello, Idaho. Pocatello, Idaho, yeah. Y'all looking at me like I'm crazy. I know y'all have it, I ain't even heard of Pocatello, Idaho. Mm-hmm. But I'm telling you, the funny thing is, at Idaho State University, I was the second African-American head, second African-American football coach in that school's history. Anybody, any idea who know the first African-American coach was? Any of y'all heard of Marvin Lewis? Used to be the head coach for the Cincinnati Bengals and the quarterback for the Ravens when they won the Super Bowl. He was the first. And I had an opportunity to meet him one time. And we joked about it. I said, look at this, you the first and I'm the second. What a difference. You know, he's right here, been in the NFL for all these 20, 30 years, and I'm sitting up here. I'm at Hank University. But I say, but seriously, though, it's just your purpose. But again, are there any questions? Hopefully something you said kind of encourage you, hopefully learn something from it. I just appreciate this opportunity.
Yeah, that's excellent.
Thank y'all so much. And if there's no question, y'all have a great day.
Appreciate that. That's good. That's excellent. Thank you so much for just sharing your wisdom, your story. I saw a lot of people taking notes. I mean, that's it right there. You've got some wisdom, and I'm sure he's got his contact information here. I think that would be my biggest takeaway. You're going to constantly have leaders around you, and I know Dr. Orr is taking advantage of those. Not every single one will you keep a lifelong mentoring, networking relationship, but you should with some. Right. And so through the symposium, through the different guest speakers that you get to have in front of you, they're not putting their contact info just because they're wanting to continue. He works at a university. He wants to invest in the next generation. Right. Any guest speaker that ever comes in front of you isn't doing it because someone's making them do it. They want to invest in the next generation. And the question will be, who will follow up and say, thank you, Dr. Orr, man. I got a connection in that area. I'd love to stay up. You know, can you help me find an internship? Like, there are people that are making themselves available too. So thank you to Professor King for establishing this and her network. She expanded her network to us, and we were all very, very privileged today for this lecture. Thank you. Professor King said, don't go to class this week. She said it. She said, you good. Which one? Let me see.
But not the other one.
We don't have class here.
I just understand a lot.
We do have class Wednesday.
Sorry, first do it. Yeah, both.
What's the other one? That's Thursday. I have checked the schedule. I can't.
Yeah, okay.
We may, but I don't know.
Yeah. Check.
Yep.
Anybody take it really hard? Like, cry?
Yeah, you were actually supposed to present last week, so you had awesome. You can't go again. That's okay. You know, and but I can't. We got to keep a schedule at this point. It's kind of the whole semester. Is there a reason why?
I'm finishing and I'm just like, okay. It might sound bad, so
it might sound great. You know what I mean? You're towards the end. You're one of the last two, and you do good. You still got 2 days. You know, so it's just 5 minutes. You know, if you want to have somebody go with you, if any of your colleagues, your peers want to split it in half, and if somebody wants to do, I'll give them extra credit. So if you want to go and ask people with that too, okay. You got this. What's that? Which one? Yes. Yep. Kalik still here? Aaron Williams?
He's not here.
Winton. Madison, Jackson, Will Nelson, Chandler, Bach, Canyon,
old stuff,
Trent, Ashley, Joe, Brandon, Chase, Dino.
I think we can't 12-2. Then we have to be at the field at 11.
Talia.
My group's supposed to present. Do you want
them
to present without me, or do you want
us
to try to do it?
Because I had to move it once, so those have to go. Right. If you want to record your section or something and have them play, we'll do that. You don't have to do a lot. You can record it, you know? Like, if you do a Zoom session, you can record a Zoom session. Is it home or away? You got to be, what time is the game?
I think it's 12 and 2. Okay. So we have to go out there at, like, 11.
William, Howard, or Wade? Just see what you can do. If you like, I'm not saying this will work, but if you need to present your uniform, do it. You know, do what you gotta do.
Okay.
And see if there's any grace as coach if you're throwing the second game.
Yeah.
Like, coach, can I just get the presentation over with? And, whatever we can do. Or if you need to record it, just have them upload it. You know, that's fine.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep. Yes, sir.
I was locked out of my account, so I could not upload it in
Blackboard.
Yeah,
you can now.
Yeah, I can right now, so I can do that right now.
Please. Yeah.
All right. Yep. Thank you.
Yep, you got it. If you need me to reset your submission, have you already submitted one?
I already submitted one.
Let me see. So. Let me clear it out and let you have the chance to do another one. All right, I'm gonna clear this attempt so it's like you never did it. So now go ahead and resubmit. It won't be kind of late, but resubmit it all. Yeah.